So just to introduce Stanislas, I don't think I have to introduce Stanislas because if somebody, he's known worldwide, but let me refer to one of his major mentors, Jean-Pierre Changeux, at this stage, because Jean-Pierre gave the idea to me and Jan, to Jan and me, about this workshop series, and he even defined the kind of a concept of this workshop series, and he gave the first talk 2 years ago, the first talk in this workshop series, and his idea was that what we should investigate is what is the common denominator endowed by nature in the human brain, and what are those neuroanatomical function and so on developments which are based on the local, cultural, family, linguistic and so on, environments, development in childhood and so on. So what is the contribution of nature and what is the contribution of nurture or societal effects? So I had to refer to it because of course Stanislas has co-authored several papers with Jean-Pierre. Of course, we have to know him for his own developments and his own works, research works, and I'm happy that he comes after Torkel, who talked about mathematics, working memory, and several similar aspects. And of course, Stanislas is worldwide renowned for his fantastic studies on the neurobiological underpinning of mathematics and several other higher cognitive functions, but today he will talk about syntax and language.
Thank you very much. Thank you. It's really a great pleasure to be here, and it's very true. I owe a lot to discussion with Jean-Pierre Changeux. I read Neuronal Man, still a great book, I think. I read it when I was 17, and the next year I met Jean-Pierre Changeux, and it changed my life, that's for sure. And I think the program of Neuronal Man is exactly the program of cognitive neuroscience. It's that we should be able to connect high-level cognitive functions with their biological basis and finally understand the mechanisms. So that is what I'm trying to do in the specific case of human cognitive functions. And today I want to talk about the case for syntax in different domains, not just in language. But as we will see, there's a form of syntax in mathematics. We can argue for syntax in music. And I would like to argue that there is something very particular about the ability for syntactic structures, which is found in the most basic situations, even in, we could barely call it music, but just basic sequence processing. And that maybe there is something uniquely human there, a sort of neuronal code that would be unique to humans. I want to start boosting your intuitions with a little movie and a much better speaker than I am. This is Bobby McFerrin. I hope we
talking
have sound.
Talking about expectations? Expectations. Watch.
Ba, ba.
Amazing. So I don't think there will be any other primate that will be able to do that. This is a case of instantaneous generalization. Bobby McFerrin goes on, and you can look at the movie on YouTube, and he says that it works with every audience. It takes just a few seconds of being exposed to this rule, and you generalize it. So it's a form of sequence processing that requires grasping a high-level rule and generalizing. And recently, my colleagues and I have been reviewing the different mechanisms for sequence representation, and we argue that there are many levels that are involved. The basic sequence representation, which is studied mostly in animals, is transition and timing. We capture the time between specific events of a sequence, and there will be a mismatch negativity, for instance, if an abnormal note is heard at the end. But that is not sufficient because it won't generalize to novel items. There is also evidence for higher level mechanisms of chunking. So for instance, if you hear a sequence of syllables and there are words that repeat, you will detect these words. But again, the specific words will be encoded. There is also evidence for higher order knowledge, and I'll come back to that at the end, ordinal knowledge, you know, number knowledge. Even animals, non-human primates, for instance, know what is first, what is second, what is last in a sequence. That's knowledge that's accessible. But I want to argue that this is still not enough to understand language or mathematics, and that what we need is at least one, perhaps two other levels. There is what we call algebraic patterns. This is the name that Gary Marcus gave to the possibility of detecting abstract patterns, such as, for instance, if you hear Totobu, Mimitu, Gagari, you recognize that there is a duplication and then something different. That's called algebraic pattern, and this, of course, implies a higher order rule. But the argument is that even that is not needed because this is still a sort of flat structure. And if we want to understand language, according to linguists, we have to have tree structures. Tree structures mean that they are nested structures, that they are phrases that are embedded into larger phrases that are embedded into larger phrases. So you hear something like those gifted car factory workers, you think it's a chain. And already started with Lashley, it was recognized this is not a chain. It's not one word follows the other. In order to understand this object, you need to postulate that there are groupings that form a sort of tree. So it's car factory, one unit, and car factory workers is a higher order unit. You cannot say that it's just linear structure. So I want to argue that there is something similar in mathematics and try to follow what happens at the brain level. I want to give a few arguments that linguists use because maybe you're not convinced. I think I see Wolf frowning a little bit about this. Maybe not. one of the best evidence is syntactic ambiguity. I give you the same exact sequence, black taxi driver, but you can understand it in two different ways. It could be a black taxi driver, or it could be a black taxi driver, okay? And it can be completely explained if you assume that there are recursive rules. This is Chomsky's contribution in the end of the 50s. So if you assume that a noun phrase can be an adjective and a noun, such as black taxi, or a noun phrase in English can be another noun phrase and a noun, such as taxi driver, that's a noun phrase, then you can build more complex structures, such as the ones that are ambiguous here. There is a famous sentence by Marx. I want to give you one example by Marx. I shot an elephant in my pajamas. How it got in my pajamas, I don't know. So this is Groucho Marx, of course. I'm not politically oriented. But you see the ambiguity here. Is the elephant in my pajamas, or am I in my pajamas? Okay, so syntactic ambiguity. I want to point out that this is all over the place. So even when you think of a single word, you have tree structures. Unlockable is ambiguous, if you think about it. Unlockable is a single word, but of course there are morphemes inside it, and it could be that it is something that it is possible to unlock, or that it is not lockable, right? So even in order to understand how we generate single words, we have to assume tree structures. And people in linguistics believe now that morphology, the constitution of words, and syntax are really the same sort of process. There are many more examples that could go on and on. There is ellipsis and substitution. Every single component of a sentence can be substituted by another, by a shorter one. So if I tell you, he drove to this big house, we could say he drove to this one, he drove to it, he drove there, he did. And in each case, you are using a shorter word as a pointer to a subpart of the sentence, a phrase structure inside the original sentence. We can move these objects during topicalization, for instance. And the objects that move are trees. They are not chains of words. And there are also long-distance dependencies. This is an interesting example. So very simple sentence. The cars that pass this truck are red. It's completely grammatical, right? You don't even notice that there is a sub-sentence, which is this truck are red, which is wrong. But why don't you notice it? Because you compute agreement over tree structures. The tree structure is the cars are red, and in between there is an embedded relative structure. Okay. So many, many arguments from linguistics suggest that we should believe in these tree structures, but neuroscientists are very conservative, so they'd like evidence. So we'll try to provide evidence. But I do want to mention that it's not just in language. If you look at this equation, you immediately recognize it is true. It is because you can parse mathematical structures, and again, you need a notion of embedding and nested phrases. And music has been analyzed in exactly the same way at several different levels, metric and tonal structures and so on. Maybe social cognition is also similar, right? You need to be able to represent, I know that you know that I don't know something. So this requires embeddings. So the question is really whether there's something uniquely human here that may have evolved and allowed us to access all of these different domains. So I'll start with language. We started to do experiments on this with Christophe Pallier, and we tried to find the right way to identify areas that care about constituent structures of language. And we thought there is a very simple hypothesis. If there is something like a merge operation that takes two objects and creates a higher order tree for them, a binary operation, this is Chomsky's postulate, then we might see that each time it is called, we see a little bit more activation in areas that are involved. So there would be more activation for the girl who talks than for the nice girl than for the girl. Now, that would be a pretty stupid experiment because the number of words is confounded. So we found a way to deconfound the number of words, and that is to say to always use 12 words, but inside those 12 words, you can have more or fewer merge operations. So this is the sort of design that we used. At the highest level, you have 12 words that form a sentence, a right branching sentence. I believe that you should accept the proposal of your new associate. We chose 12 because it has many divisors. So you can make two groups of six. So you can have the mouse that eats our cheese, two clients examine this nice couch. And it really makes two pieces, right? Or three pieces of four words. Mayor of the city hates this color, they read their names. And so on and so forth until you reach the lowest level, which is just a simple list of words, and we purposefully make it such that you cannot connect the words together at all. So think very tree where of watching copy tense, they states hard plus. Quite hard to read, but I'm well trained. So we had subjects sit in the scanner and view these objects. It was important. The first experiment was with reading because this prevents any sort of prosodic cues. It's just one word at a time. It's the same exact stimulus, basically 12 words in all conditions, but mentally you can construct tree structures of higher and higher complexity and embedding. Now, there are still problems, and in order to control for transition probability and meaning, we introduced this condition called Jabberwocky. This is in reference to Lewis Carroll, who created a poem a little bit like that. You remove the words, the content words, you change them by pseudo words, such that the meaning is gone and transition probabilities are essentially zero. Such, for instance, I perceive that you should be gapped the tropufol of your true viral flate. I tell you, it takes some training, but especially for a French speaker. But you immediately parse it. And that was Chomsky's point. Right? You can parse a colorless green ideas sleep furiously. Another example where syntax overrides in a sentence and semantics. So we replicated the entire experiment with these Jabberwocky stimuli where syntax is preserved, the syntactic words are present, the terminations of words are present, syntactic morphology is present, but there is no longer any meaning. We had a simple prediction, which was that we might see more and more activity each time you add a word and you can merge it with the preceding one. So the idea was there would be climbing activity, and then there would be drops when you can no longer integrate and you have to restart from zero, basically. So that's the model that you see on the left. And the prediction after you convolved with BOLD is that with the homodynamic response is that you would have higher and higher activity in the relevant areas as a function of constituent structure, but also delays in activity that would betray the complexity and the events that must occur at the end of the sentence. The sentence becomes more and more a rich object in a certain sense. So these are the results, and they were really showing us that there was something, there was a grain of truth here. You can see that there are several areas, mostly in the left hemisphere. A temporal pole activates a little bit in the right hemisphere. But and there is also the putamen in the subcortical regions. All of these regions show monotonic activity as a function of syntactic structure. Okay, and three of these regions, the one that are in red on this picture, in the IFG inferior frontal gyrus, Broca's area, pars triangularis, pars orbitalis, and in the posterior superior temporal sulcus, they show a monotonic activation even when you remove the semantics. You can see here these parallel curves for real sentences and Jabberwocky. And it's a really parametric effect here. So you really have a sort of additional activity for additional constituent structure building. The dissociation is very interesting. So temporal pole, for instance, seems really to care about semantic structure. So there is no change at all when you present these Jabberwocky sentences that are meaningless. So it looks like there is a core of syntax processing for language and then some more peripheral systems that do their work only if there is meaning. It's very interesting that this core does not seem to change its activity much, even when you go to Jabberwocky. Our prediction about time was also true. So these are the basic bold responses that we got. And if you look, it's not just that the peak is increasing, but it's also that the peak is shifting to the right. And we can quantify this using spectral analysis and see that there is a small delay of a few hundreds of milliseconds that progressively builds up towards the end of the sentence here. So that prediction was true. What was not true, however, is that this effect is linear. And so I cheated with you a little bit because from the beginning I'm showing you a log scale here. Very interestingly and unexpectedly for us at least, it was the log of the number of words that was predictive of bold activity. And we're still struggling to understand that. I'll propose to you a hypothesis, but it looks like this would be the real story. That the buildup in activation is not linear, perhaps due to prediction, because you're able to predict better the end of the sentence, but perhaps more interestingly, because this is reflecting the code which is underlying these sentences. If you have a tree structure, it's a binary tree, then the log is a relatively rough predictor of the depth of the tree. So we wondered whether this is the right solution. You are building these structures that are compressing the information. You don't need as many items as there are words to code this mentally. I just want to say that this is a highly replicable finding. We replicated it with spoken language that required a little work with the stimuli to remove the prosody, so we had presentations word by word like this without prosody. But the result is very much the same. You can see these areas in red here that are showing a very strong correlation with the complexity of the sentences for same number of words. There are also these negative correlations here that you can see. And we've replicated this now in Chinese. We've replicated it in sign language to some extent. So the networks are not strictly identical. I could talk about that. But let's just say there is a core network that's replicable. This core network is, in fact, present in many experiments. So one can say now, I did my whole course last year on this topic. I reviewed all of these papers. There is strong convergence from many different ways of looking at syntax. So for instance, if you do tree manipulations, you ask people to manipulate the trees in their heads to decide who did what to whom. You know, so the kids who exhausted their parents fell asleep. Who fell asleep? Did the parents fall asleep or did the kids fall asleep? Okay. When you do that, you activate this core syntax network because you have to manipulate the tree structures. If you have syntactic ambiguities, you have more activation in the same network. If you move the items, syntactic movement, you have the same sort of activation. And these are also the areas that are hypoactivated in agrammatism or that have lesions in patients who develop agrammatism in proportion to their deficit. So I think the network is well identified. What we try to do more recently is to look at the dynamics of that network. With fMRI, it's hopeless. And this has been pointed out by many speakers. fMRI will not give you the time dimension very precisely, will not give you the word-by-word happening. But we can now have intracranial recordings, similar to what Giacomo was showing. We are pulling across more than 10 subjects here that had intracranial recordings for epilepsy. Purposes for epilepsy exploration. And we use this and high gamma responses to track what happens word by word in a sentence. And our work was guided by a revision of this naive model here. So I've shown you this naive model already where each word would simply add one more merge operation. But the truth is, if we believe the linguist, there are three structures like this. And we reason that maybe if you have a sentence like Bill Gates made two very tired dancers in Dallas, strange sentence indeed, you can build activation, but when you reach a moment where you can group them together to form a constituent, then maybe the activation would decrease, okay? Because you create a package of information. And then it's this package which is passed on to the rest of the computation. It's no longer Bill Gates, but it's a single phrase which is being passed on to the next and can be bound, as for instance, as a subject to the verb. Likewise, when you reach very tired, that's a constituent, you can put it together, and so on and so forth. So this model would predict that there is increases, but also sudden decreases, as you can merge the information together, and that we should be able to see these merges if we look word by word. So that's what we did. And let me show you one example of what happens in these electrodes. So this is an electrode in the posterior superior temporal sulcus here. What you see in colors is the high gamma response. This is the beginning of the sentence. The white bar here is the end of the sentence. We have sentences from 3 words to 10 words in this experiment. And we also have lists of words down here. I think you can immediately see that there is remarkable signal to noise. Each line is one sentence. Each line is just one trial, unaveraged, okay? And you can see that we are tracking the length of the sentence, first of all. And that's not true for the list of words, or much less so. The list of words, you have activation at the beginning, subjects are trying to remember them, and then it drops. Okay. So we see this buildup very clearly as a function of stimulus length when it's a sentence, but not so much when it's a list of words. Well, that's the beginning. Then we can look at the activation arranged in different ways. So here we align it to the last word, okay? And you immediately see that there is a burst of activation at the last word of the sentence, which allows you to pack it all together. And that burst of activation is proportional to the length, or at least it's modulated by length. And this is not the case in a word list here. These effects occur in these electrodes that are marked in red here. And you immediately see that they very nicely track the language network that I was showing you earlier. There is no Jabberwocky here, so I think we are seeing the extended network, syntax plus semantic, wherever there is constituent structure buildup. But in these areas, there's a sort of sentence wrap-up effect, which depends on sentence length, especially in the IFG here, and which might relate to the fact that when you read a sentence, you slow down at the end, because that's when you need to pack the information together. So that's the end of sentence effect. But if my view is correct, there should also be inside the sentence constituent structure building. So now this is again the same data, but I have reordered it inside the sentences according to where the constituents close. So it can be the second position, there's a black mark here, or the third, or the fifth, or the sixth. Okay? And I hope you can see that there seems to be events that are locked to these moments. So for instance, there's much more sustained activity here when the first constituent is larger, something like the three daughters of Bill Gates or something like that. So this is what we find when we look at the average gamma activity across time for this electrode. You can see, for instance, what happens when the first non-phrase is only 2 words, 10 students, and then it drops. If you have 10 students of Bill Gates, you get the same sort of initial activity with a little bit of noise, and then it resumes again. Okay. To create a larger NP. Likewise, if you have a group of 3 words, 10 sad students, you get the light blue curve here. It starts like 10 students, but then it goes on, okay? And if it's 10 sad students of Bill Gates, goes on and on, drops, and then up, shoots back up because I have to complete the non-phrase. Right? So we think that we can track non-phrase structures with this sort of drops in high gamma activity. And it's not just non-phrases, but also verb phrases. In fact, after each word, we can look at what is the total number of open nodes, not number of words, but number of words or tree structures that have not been merged together, that have to be held in a sort of working memory. And you can see this is a very good predictor of activation just after that word here. And then it may drop dramatically. For instance, we never exceed 6, so it always drops in this case. So again, this effect of open node tracking is found very much in the same language areas that we found earlier, all along the STS, all the way to the temporal pole, inferior frontal gyrus. We had surprisingly a bit of dorsal activation. This has been found now in this recent Nature mapping paper. It looks like there are some overlooked language activations more dorsally and also medially here. And also these areas in the precuneus, they are relatively frequent actually in language processing. So all of this is quite interesting, but the core is already present here. Now we can ask a great question. This is the Chomsky question. If this view is right, this concept of total number of open nodes implicitly assumes that a single word and a multi-word phrase count for the same. They will give you the same amount of activation, contribute the same amount of additional brain activity. This is really a key hypothesis of merge, right? It should apply to any linguistic object, can apply to a single word or to a very complex tree that you have already built. So we can test that by having regressors separately for the number of pending words and for the number of constituents that are already closed but are still pending because they may still be merged by others. So when you reach Bill Gates, you form one closed constituent here. but you still have it pending because it needs to be merged with the rest of the sentence. So these two numbers are decorrelated from each other, and we can ask how do they contribute separately to the high gamma activity. For the moment, I was just using the total variable here, total number of open nodes, and I showed you this is a predictor of activity. The question now is, are these two predictors the same? And across electrodes, we found that yes, the betas of a regression for these two variables are highly correlated with each other, with a slope which is essentially very close to one. So what that means is there is the same amount of additional activity for a single word and for a large tree that you've already merged. Once they're merged, the cost is very low for the brain. It's the same cost as for a single word. So this is really compatible with this idea that the brain compresses the information. There's a sort of mental compression that occurs each time you can make a constituent. And it's true almost all over the brain. So this is the betas for the number of pending words. These are the betas for the number of closed constituents. You can see pretty good match between the two. But there are some areas where it's not so true. So for instance, you can clearly see here the precuneus seems to be conspicuously different. And it's showing more activity for constituents than for words, probably because this is the output of the system. So we think that the areas that are showing more activity for the closed constituents may be more encoding the output of the sentence. And that could be the case also for the temporal pole and this more temporoparietal junction activation. We also find that the merge operation itself seems to be accompanied by transient activity. So this is a slightly different regressor here, where we ask, is there activation at the very moment where you merge? Not just climbing each time there is a word that cannot be merged, but at the moment where you merge. And we find activation that looks very much like this. So you can see here the amount of gamma activity essentially proportional to the number of nodes that you have to close sharply at the moment where you have to do the merge operation. That sort of activation is again found in a distributed manner, but largely in the inferior frontal gyrus pars triangularis here. So in summary, it looks like the brain is acting as a compressor of sentences. It's creating these tree structures, and we find these effects in a distributed manner in the language circuit. They can explain the log effect that we found in the fMRI. And that's why I'm so happy with this finding, because I think it bridges between these two different techniques. If we integrate... No. No, it's not true. So what you see here is the leads that show this open node tracking. So many of them do it. But then you have the... Sorry? All the red dots in one given graph have this effect of open node tracking. Not necessarily the same size, but and they may have an additional effect. You see some electrodes here, for instance, that have this additional effect at the moment where you merge the activity. Yeah. So yeah, the fact that there is so much probably means that we are not dividing correctly the different aspects of the merge, right? So for instance, if we do, we are starting this now, Jabberwocky experiment, we expect that maybe we'll get rid of some of these anterior temporal activations because there is no meaning anymore. So, in fact, this will be one message of my talk, that there are constituent structures all over the place. Some are syntactic, some are semantic. We can begin to decompose them. Right? Yeah. So you can see that instead of a linear increase, which would be this line here, we have a sublinear increase in the number of open nodes at any given moment. And this may explain the sort of log-like shape in the fMRI. Well, time is flying, and I do want to speak about mathematics a little bit. But question is, what's the relation of this to our ability for mathematics? Is it the case that we use language for mathematics, or do we use something very different? And do we need to assume some kind of combinatorial ability? If you look at Galileo, Galileo is very clear, and I think Galileo is a hero of our science, but this book, he meant the universe, is written in the mathematical language. The symbols are triangles, circles, and other geometrical figures without whose help it is impossible to comprehend a single word of it. The question, of course, is what is this language? How does it relate to natural language? And here there is a debate. Chomsky sees syntax of natural language as the origin of everything, and in particular math. He says that math is an abstraction from language. But there is the alternative, and I think if you ask many mathematicians and physicists, they say, no, I'm not doing language at all. When I do mathematics, words and language, whether written or spoken, do not seem to play any part in my thought processes. And I combine signs or images, but not words. There is a real debate here. I side with Einstein. First, this is my intuition. I was trained as a mathematician, and it's my strong intuition, just like Einstein. Intuition is not sufficient, so I want to show you data. But also, it arises naturally from the idea that I was developing in the number sense book, that number sense is a foundation, non-linguistic foundation for mathematics, and we build upon it by the ability to recombine this ability with other abilities, such as the spatial ability, for instance. So I expect from this model that it's the foundation of mathematics would be found more in numerical abilities or in spatial abilities than in linguistic abilities. But it could still be that language is needed to act as a sort of glue between these different systems. And this is the view of Elisabeth Spelker, that we have core systems that are non-linguistic for space, for time, for number, but we need the linguistic glue to glue them together. So who is right? So we started to do experiments of the same kind that I showed you earlier. And for instance, if we do experiments that are very similar in that they use words, we can do that in the domain of number, right? So we can present very complex number, such as 662, well, sorry, I won't even try to name it, although that's my native language, but you can imagine the experiment. I'd say 354 is a perfectly good number, but if I say 450, 103, it's a list of words, and you cannot merge it anymore. And you can imagine intermediate situations, right? So we did exactly the same experiment as before, and the finding was this, both in French and in Chinese, by the way, that there is a very strong contribution of left inferior frontal gyrus all over what is considered Broca's area, but quite extended, including this more, you know, posterior and dorsal component here. But instead of the posterior temporal sulcus and these other temporal areas, we find this more parietal activation, which we routinely find associated with number. So it looks as if perhaps some of the binding is still done by the same sort of region, but the origin of the binding may be different here, maybe in the parietal cortex. We have other experiments where we look at algebra, and when we look at algebra, the answer is that it does not seem to overlap at all with the activations involved in language processing. So if we go away from language, natural language, and we present these equations, which are the language of mathematics, these equations also have a sort, or these expressions, also have a sort of nested structure, right? That's why the parentheses are there. But even if there were no parentheses, there was multiplication, for instance. You understand that multiplication has precedence over addition. Well, we can start from such an expression, and then we can scramble it progressively so we have less and less structure all the way to just a list of symbols. But now they're presented all at once on the screen. It's quite interesting that mathematical notation is making use of space rather than a sequence across time. If you present these symbols one after the other, even in this condition, you understand nothing. Mathematics is strongly dependent on the spatial format of the formula. So we wondered, you know, would we get the same sort of activation as before? It's the same sort of manipulation. We change the structure of the stimuli, but now it's algebra. The answer is completely different brain areas. These are the areas we found for written language, just a reminder of the previous experiment. This is what we found for mathematical expressions. We found very occipital-temporal regions and these intraparietal regions. The ones we find always for mathematics and calculation and so on, but not at all the language areas. I want to show you the latest experiment we have done where we really pushed this quite far by looking at professional mathematicians. We wondered, you know, maybe we really have to see what happens in these people who made mathematics a profession. Maybe they would rely on language areas. It's not easy to think of what experiment you should do with them. For many years, I wanted to do an experiment. I have many colleagues in mathematics, including at a very high level, such as Alain Cohn or Cédric Villani, who are Fields Medal winner. And I just didn't know what experiment to do with them. You know, do you have them come to the lab and look at these very stupid calculations, like 3 minus 1 plus 2? That didn't seem right. So I was trying to find the right idea to look at them. And finally, with Maria Malric, who is the first author of that study, we thought that we could do the right experiment. So first of all, we found some professors of humanities that are of supposed matched academic standing. Of course, it's very difficult to assure that this is the case, but without mathematical training. The second is we designed this task which involves an intuitive component of mathematics. We really wanted to look at the higher level structures that allow you, in a few seconds, to decide whether something is true or false. So this is how the experiment went. There is a sentence presentation, then you have to think about what you hear, and you have to decide whether it's true, false, or meaningless. And the statements can be mass or they can be non-mass. So let me test you.
There is no non-vanishing continuous tangent vector field on even dimensional spheres.
Are there mathematicians in the room? Is this true or false? This is the question we're asking our mathematicians. You can see how difficult it is. But it's actually true. This is a true statement. Let me give you another one.
The trace of a unit ball diverges in any dimension different from 1 and infinity.
What do you think? This is complete gibberish. It's like jabberwocky, almost. This is meaningless. It looks like math, right? But it's not math at all. It's just words pieced together. Okay, so the mathematicians could reject these quite easily. But for the other statements, they have to think a little bit more, whether it's math or whether it's true or not true. And we had statements that were just difficult, but not involving math.
In ancient Greece, a citizen who couldn't pay his debt was made a slave.
True or false? Wolf. Apparently it's true that if you couldn't pay your debt, you would be made a slave. Okay. In ancient Greece. So you have to bring your knowledge. These tasks are very similar. We start with a sentence, they're the same complexity, same length and everything. You have to bring your knowledge together on the task to decide whether they're true or false. You make an intuitive judgment. You have no time to calculate or anything like that. But the question is, do you activate the same areas in math and in non-math? So we also had calculation tasks and a visual localizer. I won't talk much about that, although there are interesting results there. But this is the main finding, that the mathematicians, when they hear math, activate a whole different network from when they hear non-math. So all of the areas that you see here are showing more activity for math than for non-math when it's meaningful. And you can see that there is a shooting up of the activation just for any area of math, whether it's analysis, algebra, topology, geometry, compared to the non-math statements, which essentially stay down or even drop below the baseline here. You can see these areas, they're bilateral, posterior parietal, lateral parietal cortex, lateral inferotemporal, occipitotemporal region, and this very important dorsal swath of prefrontal cortex going down a little bit here, but not really in Broca's area. Come back to that. Very bilateral also. Very common to all sorts of mathematics. If you do the reverse contrast, there are areas that are involved for general semantic knowledge, but they are completely different from those involving mathematics. This is a rather known network, although understudied to my opinion, but this is involving essentially the middle temporal gyrus, the more anterior part here going into the temporal pole, bilateral, and also this more like temporoparietal junction here, posterior part of the superior temporal sulcus, again bilateral. And in each of these regions, you see this very strong activation by the semantic knowledge facts, but not by mathematics. So it's an almost complete dissociation. Here, it's of course a bit trivial because it's one pitted against the other, but I can have this independent contrast, which is meaningful versus meaningless. Mathematicians work much more when it's meaningful compared to meaningless. So you see this directly in the activation, and that difference will isolate the blue network here. And if we make the same difference for non-mathematical statements, we also had meaningless non-mathematical statements. You can see again this difference of activation, but now it's in the green areas. There is virtually no overlap. Okay. So the representation of mathematical meaning versus non-mathematical meaning is sharply different. And by the way, this is true only in the mathematicians. So the non-mathematicians don't show mathematical related activation to these sorts of statements, at least, right? That's completely normal because they don't understand them. So they treat them as gibberish. What about language areas? What are they doing? After all, I'm giving them language, right? Everything is conveyed in language. So as you would expect, there is a transient activation of all of these language areas I was talking about before. They have a transient activity to the statement, and then a drop. Okay. And that activation is either completely identical to all of the five type of sentences, or if anything, it's more activated by the non-mass sentences. Okay, so there is no evidence for a specific activation to the mathematics here. In fact, the areas that I'm showing you are remarkably distinct. So regardless of how we identify the network in red is the language network activated by spoken and written sentences. That's the one I was showing you before. And the areas in yellow completely contour this language network. And there is virtually no area of overlap. And in single subjects, there is none either. So what is this mass network? Well, in fact, it's a network that we know very well and which has been involved in the past in number processing and calculation. So even in the same subject here, we also localized areas that would be activated by numbers, just flashing numbers as opposed to other pictures. And we also identified areas activated by calculation more than by sentence processing. And all of these areas intersect. The yellow is the intersection here. You can see how similar the networks are. So we find parietal areas that have been involved in number sense in the past. And we also find what has been called the visual number form area. It's a much more recently discovered area by Joseph Parvizi's team. Using intracranial electrodes, they identify this area, which is responsive to Arabic numerals much more than to other stimuli, including letter stimuli. So it seems that the activation in this area can grow into a much larger circuit, which becomes active during abstract mathematics. We seem to start with a network that does number and can recognize number symbols, but if you train very hard in mathematics, you will grow out of this system a much greater ability to do abstract high-level mathematics. But it's completely outside of language areas. Interestingly, I mean, this growth is really literal in the amount of activation. So when we just measure the activation to numbers, there is more activation to the same numbers in mathematicians compared to non-mathematicians. Also, in this area, there is activation to visual presentations of formulas, expressions, like Schrödinger's equation, for instance. They will activate these areas very strongly, and that's not found in non-mathematicians. So there is a form of specialization above and beyond what everybody shares. We share the number representation probably since birth. We develop this Arabic number representation, but only the mathematicians go on to a higher level representation. Okay, so, maybe I'll skip that, but we can reject various artifactual interpretation. It's not due to the presence of numbers in the statements. There were very few numbers, even if we remove the few statements that involve things like half, for instance, or unit, we still get this activation. We also still get if we control for task difficulty, which in fact was very well matched. There was a slight difference in subjective difficulty, but even if we take the easiest math problem, if we compare them to the hardest non-math problem, we still get these networks. So it's not task difficulty. Furthermore, there is a lot of converging evidence for this dissociation, which I'm showing you today. One of the most interesting is aphasia. You can be deeply aphasic and agrammatic and still be able to process algebraic expressions and complex calculation, nested calculations. So you may still be able to know that a plus b cubed is a cubed plus 3, a b squared plus 3, a squared b plus b cubed without being able to process the grammar of language. This is really quite remarkable. There are also many other experiments. I don't have time, I think, to detail them, but that have used quite minute, well-matched protocols, perhaps better matched than the one I'm showing you today, and shown the same sort of dissociation between syntax processing versus arithmetic processing. So we have to converge to the conclusion that there's not just one area for mathematics and for language. It's not just one area for whenever there are nested, complicated structures, but probably there are several different duplicated circuits with syntactic structures. So we are now trying to simplify all of this. Of course, going to very high-level statements is not going to help us to understand the neural coding of these things. So we need to go to simpler structures. And we are now doing experiments, this is not published yet, where we're trying to look at a minimal language of geometry. Let me explain this to you, and this will connect also to the previous talk on spatial working memory. So imagine that you're a little child, we test children and adults, who is looking at this octagon, there are 8 possible positions, and you are told that you will be looking at a fish. There are different animals. They like to hide, and they like to jump from one location to the other, and your task is to predict where the animal will go next, okay? So look at what the fish does. Where will it go next? You know? Maybe here? Good, you're good. Okay, now think about this. It's just like the initial experiment, the initial example I showed you of Bobby McFerrin, right? You have not seen the full sequence yet, but you know. You think you know, and you're right in this case. But what you do here is you generalize based on a regularity, which is in fact not even involving a repetition. Nothing has been repeated yet. What has been repeated is the parallelism of these lines, right? And you immediately extrapolate. It's almost jumping to conclusions. Now, we designed experiments so that we could explore many of these sequences and see which ones you get and which ones you don't get, okay? And so it's a form of spatial memory, but I would argue that spatial memory is not just a sort of list of locations, but in these cases, at least, there are regularities. And when there are regularities, just like in the sentence case, it helps. You can package the information here. You can say, oh, there were groups of two, okay? Obviously, they were parallel to each other. There should be another group of two. So we think that a language is needed, a sort of programming language is needed in order to account for this sort of task. And the simplified language that we've designed here with Mariano Sigman and Santiago Figuera is a sort of programming language where you can create nested structures. So for instance, the example that you saw is of this kind, where you have a horizontal movement, so you need to have primitives like horizontal movement, and then you need the ability to do recursive structures by repetition at least. So you repeat the horizontal movement four times while moving the starting point by one. That's what this formula means. Okay. But I would like to convince you that we need such formulas. If we only have flat structures, then we cannot account for the memory of the subject, because that's how the memory of the subject looks like, and the predictive ability and the memory. So what you see here is, as a function of where we stop in the sequence, we stop at the third item all the way to repeating. Here we start to repeat. It's a sequence of eight, and then we start to repeat it. And we go all the way to the 16th location here. What you see is the ability to correctly predict. So zero is good. Here is the amount of errors. And you can see what happens to a random sequence. I shouldn't say random, but let's say irregular, sort of a sequence where there is no obvious regularity, versus each of these sequences that just involve, for instance, going around the circle. That's what we call repeat. The one that you just saw is this one. It's called four segments here. You can see that compared to an irregular sequence, everybody, children, adults, we also tested people in the Amazon who have no education, they are much better even before having had any sort of repetition. That's the left part of the curve here. And then if we repeat, they are also much, much better at memorizing these sequences compared to a random one. We choose eight, of course, because it's beyond working memory for most subjects, so eight is really difficult, but it's not difficult at all if you get one of these sequences which can be parsed, basically, by this language. So there is one way to formalize this, and it's called Kolmogorov complexity. I don't know if you know about Kolmogorov complexity. It's a mathematical concept. The better name is minimal description length. The idea is very simple, is the cost of storing this sort of sequence will be determined by how long is the program. If you have a very simple program, like always go plus one, it's a very short program, you don't have any problem storing it. The problem of storing it will be proportional to the length of the program. So that's what you see here. The minimal description length is on the x-axis, and you can see the performance, percent errors, in different groups of subjects, these preschoolers or Munduruku adults. There is a very nice correlation between what is predicted by the language and how the subjects perform. And it's not at all the sort of flat line that you would get if there was no encoding of regularities. The preschoolers deviate a little bit, and we can show that they are using a simpler language. They don't have point symmetry, for instance, and they don't go to the same levels of embedding as the older subjects. And the same for these less educated people. So a simplified language is needed. And what I like about these experiments is progressively we hope we'll be able to converge on the right type of language which is needed, a sort of language of thought. I think many of you are familiar with this classic book by Fodor, The Language of Thought. I think this is what we are after here. But it's not necessarily natural language. I'll skip that and just mention that I like this experiment also because it does not need to be explicit. It could be just implicit. So here, we're not asking subjects anything else than to follow with their eyes the target. Okay. But if you understand, then your eyes go earlier to the target. So if we measure the amount of anticipation, we get an idea of whether they understood the sequence or not. Right? And ultimately, we will be able to do that in the monkey. We're starting to do that. This is in human. But we get exactly the same result by just using eye movements and a sort of active but, you know, very little instruction situation. So then we can scan the subjects, and this was done by Liping Wang in the lab. We scan subjects while they are doing this eye tracking task, and we find that there are areas that care about the minimal description length. Their activation varies as a function of this minimal description length. They have more activation for the more difficult sequences as a function of the complexity predicted by this language model. And very interestingly, once we remove possible effects of saccade distance or working memory load, we get essentially restricted areas that are well predicted by this minimal description length that are within the general inferior frontal regions, but at the same time, they are very dorsal, and once again, they avoid the bulk of what would be Broca's area according to a language localizer. So we have a language localizer in the same subjects. We can show that the language areas are not showing this effect, but it's a more dorsal effect. It looks very much like what we had with this high-level mass, where you could see the frontal activations are carefully avoiding, as it were, the core of the language system, but they are just a little bit more dorsal. So this is my main hypothesis now. And it's derived from prior work by Peter Haggart, which I'm happy to cite here. The hypothesis is that there is not one merged system. We should not think that there was one mutation and one brain area, such as Broca's area, suddenly gained a new function. Something happened to multiple networks, and there may well be multiple parallel networks that each have the ability to create nested structures. And this ability for nested structures is all over the place in human cognition. I think we could discuss it, but I would argue that it is present in tool use as well, or at least in tool making. When humanity started to make multi-component tools, where there's a handle and an X, and they are bound together by lace and something like that, this becomes the moment where we are using combinatorial thought structures. And we see it in tools, but we also see it in mathematical-like drawings very early on in South Africa, for instance, 70,000 years old. So it looks like something happened to multiple circuits at once. And I would argue that as a consequence, we are able to have a communicative language which is very rich. But in my opinion, it's not that language was there first and everything else evolved. It is that there is a core system of thought that evolved, and then language was a consequence of that. Speculation, of course, but at least we have to admit that it looks like there are multiple circuits for language representation. If I have 5 more minutes, good, okay, I think we're still good with time. I would like to finish by telling you of our efforts to bring this down to an actual comparison of the monkey brain and the human brain to ask whether there are really circuit differences and that there is something unique to humans, even when they are presented with the very same stimuli. So we're still working with the same idea. We would love to have minimal sequence learning or so-called mini languages that would be simple enough that they can be presented to a monkey and it's meaningful. It would be meaningless to present sentences to a monkey, because they have no chance, right? But perhaps it's meaningful to present the sort of sequence that Bobby McFerrin was showing at the beginning, or something even simpler, and to ask, does the monkey understand it? What does he understand about the sequence? Okay. So we want to have naive monkeys that are just trained to fixate, remain still in the scanner, and then we expose them to these sequences, and we see how they represent them in the brain. We compare to humans in the very same task. And the way we do this is we look for fMRI responses to deviants. It's the deviants to the sequence that will tell us how the monkeys represent the information. So let me give you an exact example. Here is the sort of pattern that we presented. So I hope 4 repetitions was enough for you to get the idea. It's always 3 items, and then there is a different one. The rhythm can change, the tempo, the duration of the notes, the pitch of the notes, they all change. So the only thing that's regular is that there is 3, and then there is another one, okay? That's the question we want to ask. You know, can monkeys grasp something like this? And if they do, what do they understand exactly? Do they understand that there are 3 notes, or maybe a total of 4? Do they understand that the last note should be different? Do they really have a complete representation of the whole thing? So in order to do that, we present some test stimuli where, first of all, one test stimulus is just a new exemplar of the same rule. We have new items, new frequencies. These are the new colors here, but it's the same rule as before. And I can immediately tell you there was no response to these. So the monkey was generalizing to these new items. Then we present deviance. So we can have number deviance. We present only two tones or six tones in total. But the last item is still different. So it's just a pure number change. We can also create a sequence change by violating the rule that the last item should be different, okay? But having the correct total number. And we can have double deviance, where number is wrong, sequence is wrong. And we scan the subjects with the same scanner, two different species. We look first at the monkey. We found that the monkeys were sensitive to number and to sequence. So whenever there was a change in number of different areas were responding to that change. And they were responding in such a way that you can see here, for instance, in the internal part of the intraparietal sulcus, corresponding perhaps to area VIP, you can see that when the number does not change, there is no reaction or even a decrease in activation. But whenever the number changes, whether or not it's accompanied by a change of sequence, you have this very strong activation. The profile is the same in these different areas. We were very happy to see it around VIP because this is where Andreas Nieder and others and myself, we found that there are strong responses to number in humans, but also in the monkey, even in the untrained monkey. I don't know if you know this work, but there are cells, single neurons in this area that care about number, that will fire specifically to a particular number of items. So you can find neurons that prefer three items in VIP, in PFC as well, or four items, or five items, and so on. So we think that this is just this population of neurons responding here, even in untrained monkeys, right? This is a sense that they have of number. There are additional activations dorsally in the prefrontal cortex in area 6, dorsal part, and other activations that I let you see here. But the important point is that we get a different set of activations when we change the sequence. So in this case, we don't show a different tone as the last item. You can see the profile is very different. If we look, let's say, at the anterior superior temporal sulcus here, you can see a strong reaction when the last item is not what it should be, but no reaction when the number changes. And a strong reaction when both change, right? So different profiles suggest a main effect of sequence change. This was found, for instance, in the caudate nucleus, which has been involved in sentence processing. And as you can see, posterior STS, more ventral part of area 6 here, anterior insula as well. But very different network from the one that we found when number was changing. And so maybe that's a very core summary of what we've been finding here. Two different networks corresponding, roughly speaking, to the dorsal and ventral auditory pathways that have been described in monkeys, responding separately to a change of number or to an unexpected twist in the sequence. Well, what happened in the humans? Humans also showed number responses, and they also appeared in the parietal cortex. You can see, for instance, this very nice activation, the right intraparietal sulcus here, more lateral side, and that's for number change. Humans also showed response to sequence change. But you can see in monkeys, there was this sequence change here in green. The key difference is that humans have an intersection of the number change and the sequence change. That is to say, they have areas that respond to both. And these are the areas that are in yellow here. And you can see where they are. And when I saw where they are, I was really very interested. They are in the inferior frontal region. They are in the posterior superior temporal sulcus and also in the right hemisphere here. And they are very close, at least structurally speaking, to this core syntax network that I was showing you for language. We had a language localizer in the very same subjects. We looked specifically at language-activated voxels, and these specific voxels, subject-specific voxels, were showing both effects of number and effects of sequence. So at least in this context, when it is a sort of auditory sequence, and you can parse it according to a very simple language, it looks like language areas are being activated by these stimuli and by violations of these stimuli. Now, you may say this is a null finding in the monkey. We have no intersection of these two networks, just a null finding. Maybe we didn't search hard enough, or the threshold was too high, or something like that. So we can show it's not just a null finding, because we can show that there is a sort of active dissociation in the monkey and active association in the human. So if we create a search region in the IFG, for instance, and we ask, are the patterns for number change and sequence change similar? In humans, they are similar. They are positively correlated. That's what you see here. But in the monkey, they tend to be negatively correlated. So if there is a voxel is activated for number, it tends to be less activated for sequence, but in humans it tends to be the same voxels. Okay. So I think, and this creates a significant difference between species, humans versus monkeys. So it really looks like humans are doing something particular here. They are integrating the information. And I think the conclusion from these experiments are quite clear. The monkeys are sensitive to the features. They have the feature of four tones, and they know when it's not there. They have the idea that one item should be different, or the last item should be different. But they don't seem to put it all together. And the suggestion is that only humans can conceive of an abstract representation of the entire pattern, the one that immediately jumped to your mind. It's three tones and then another one. If we think of it, in order to represent something like that, you need really a sort of minimal tree structure. Three tones as part A, then one other as part B. Okay. So that's how you would code it in language. I'm not arguing this is necessarily coded in the very same format as language, but I think that these tree structures are indispensable. And so a violation of any of these properties would create a violation of the whole tree structure and would make these areas react. So I think I'm reaching the end of my talk. I just want to conclude by saying that, first of all, that we have to accept that it's more complex than we initially thought. There are distinct parallel circuits for the complex tree structures underlying language and mathematics. And they are really very different. And even inside the language, we have to distinguish between core syntax versus more semantically oriented areas. There are also areas involved in phonology. There are areas involved in morphology. So there are probably many sub-distinctions to be made even inside the language system itself. Now, the language circuit will respond to elementary auditory sequences, but these circuits are uniquely developed in the human species. And I could have shown you also evidence from just analysis of the anatomy, the amount of surface area dedicated to these regions in humans compared to other primates. It's very clear that there is an expansion of this general circuitry of the inferior frontal as well as the more posterior temporal and inferior parietal regions in humans. Monkeys do possess sophisticated abilities, but only humans seem to possess the right circuitry to put together this information in the form of formulas in a sort of language of thought and to compress the information. And we benefit from that by being able to find structure in the external world. I think this is the key role of mathematics, to be able to find structures in the external world. So this is the hypothesis for the future, that the human inferior frontal gyrus contains multiple areas that operate as a binding system that integrates representation from other brain areas and transiently merges them into complex nested structures. And of course, we are interested in studying this in a more detailed manner in the case of spatial sequences, as I told you, and sequential auditory or visual structures. The idea is that what we take as very simple is in fact not simple at all. Even a spatial sequence like Torkel you were studying might involve this sort of linguistic or compressive codes. And we have to be very careful if we want to avoid them. But I think it's a key feature of human cognition. So these are the people who really did the work. All of this work has been done in collaboration with Christophe Pallier. Maria Malric did the math. Lipping was working on the monkeys. And Bashir Jaraya is the head of the monkey team with whom all of this work was done. Thank you very much for your attention.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. And let me be a bit selfish before I give the word to the floor. I have to ask a question because this question is in me for at least 10 years since I attended a meeting organized by Wolf in Frankfurt in his Ernst Strüngmann Institute on the origins of language. And somebody in the room, a fantastic one week long discussion series, somebody came up with a hypothesis. Language structures, this nested structure or the language tree within a sentence that you described, say the units or, and if you can even extend it to the clauses, remind very much the foraging structure of a foraging animal or a foraging human. So you can go up to four branching, and you can still easily come back to your original point. Mm. And I don't remember, maybe Wolf, you remember who came up with this hypothesis, but foraging behavior and the fact that you can include four clauses in a sentence, you can nest it and make a composite sentence, is still okay. But above four clauses, you lose the meaning, or you tend to lose the meaning. So somebody came up with this hypothesis that language structures, come from our foraging behavior. I don't know.
But well, yes, I have a paper, an old paper by John O'Keefe, where he suggests that the hippocampus has been hooked by linguistic structures, and maybe that's a possibility. I'm not completely convinced. I think in your example, it could be that you just remember a sequence of I turn left, I turn right. And plus, of course, you have a cognitive map that may be guiding you towards a long-term goal. So all of this may help, but I don't think it's direct evidence for tree structures. Now, this is being debated in the literature. For instance, it's discussed whether birdsong may already involve some tree structures, maybe minimal ones. And there is an interesting idea which Mark Hauser is trying to develop, that perhaps animals would have occasionally hit upon some sort of recursive structures, but only in a modular manner. And what is so typical of humans is that this is a non-modular thing. It's applicable to all sorts of domains. So all of these, I think, are interesting hypotheses. But the bulk of the evidence is that there is no recursive processing in animals whatsoever.
Wolf, Guy, you wanted to say something?
This nesting of relations, temporal relations, is a big problem for neural networks. They can't really do it well. I remember a proposal by Shastri, a linguist from Berkeley, who suggested that one, and this was long before all this oscillation business has been described and discovered, that one could solve the problem with temporal codes that are nested cross-frequency coupling. Now, this reminds me now the data that David Purple, for example, gets, that the chunking operation is reflected in different frequency ranges. So the question, you must have these intracranial data filtered at various frequency ranges. Do you see a MN relation of frequencies occurring in the moment when the chunking is done? Does it?
Yeah. Well, there are many questions in there. The first one, unfortunately, is no longer true. So deep convolution networks with learning through time are able to find structures even in programs and linguistic structures. So it's a changing field. I saw some remarkable evidence. For instance, they could generate correct programs in a programming language with all of the proper placement of parentheses matching each other and so on. So these systems can learn to use a stack, basically. So neural networks keep changing. And I'm not so convinced that you need oscillations for this. So the Lucia Meloni and David Purple work in Nature Neuroscience is very beautiful, but I don't think it means that frequencies are used for coding. I think there's a little bit of a play on words here, because what they do is they present binary structures. So you have groups of two words, very similar to our Pallier et al. Experiment. We have groups of two words, then the groups can be grouped into four words, and so on. So it's not surprising that you should see frequencies that track these structures. It's beautiful. It's a lovely way to see it. But the fact that you see these frequencies does not mean that they are used as the code.
But the temporal structure is not in the sequences. It emerges only from a mental process of chunking.
Oh, that's absolutely right.
So
yes. There
is at least a very close association. It's not just induced.
But you see, even a spatial coding model would predict that there would be frequencies. For instance, the model I showed you today would predict that we'd be climbing and then dropping, and climbing and dropping. So in the spectral domain, this would create these frequencies, even if frequencies are not used for coding.
So well, a frequency is never a code. It's...
Well, I mean temporal coding, yeah. So I don't think that...
It's not the frequency that codes. I think this is, this is, as one would never say, a local field potential is a code or whatever. It is the reflection of a neuronal activity that is temporally structured. And somehow in this chunking, you have to establish temporal relations, otherwise you wouldn't be able to learn those chunks.
Well, I think we can agree that there is structuring by time. I mean, obviously the words come in a linear structure, and mentally they are grouped, and we can see the grouping events. I simply think that it does not imply that there is any form of temporal coding inside the brain. The timing of activation may just be a reflection of the processes that are occurring at different moments. That's something for us to analyze, obviously. And you were asking specifically, did we analyze the cross-frequency nesting? Not yet. All that I've shown for the moment is based on high gamma responses. So, of course, we will look carefully at this hypothesis.
Yeah, thank you. Very interesting talk. Just two brief questions. First, about the abilities of the monkeys to discriminate sequences. It wasn't really clear to me if you tried sequences where the deviant node was placed in the middle as well, for instance,
no.
Or if you looked at all at temporal deviants, if they can perceive rhythmic differences.
No.
This
is a very limited experiment.
The
problem with these experiments is you need to have rare deviants, right?
Yeah.
And yet they must not be too rare because you want to measure brain activity to them. So we are quite limited in how much we can explore.
So is it sequence discrimination or just that they trigger on the change in pitch?
Well, it is triggered by a change in pitch, except that change in pitch can be up or down, any change, essentially. So it's a bit abstract. It's not very abstract. I think it's just on the edge. I never expected, by the way, that this experiment alone would be sufficient to show such a big difference between monkeys and humans. So I was very surprised. This was the first experiment we did, and you can see the syntax is essentially very stupid. It's barely syntax, just juxtaposition of two groups. But maybe already in this case, language areas are being recruited.
The other thing was just in the mathematician study, did you look at all whether there were any differences between mathematicians with different backgrounds in relation to the questions, if the topologists were better at, you know.
Right, we tried, but no, we couldn't find any such effect. But it could just be that our classifications are wrong. Mm. Both for the mathematicians, it's very hard to classify, but also with respect to the stimuli. Israeli is one mathematics, right? So we say it's, let's say, topology, but that's not true. I mean, the facts of mathematics are really integrated together very well. So we accepted the labels that the mathematicians gave to these statements, but I think it's much more complicated than that. According to what we know about number, even understanding number already involves a relation to space, for instance. So I think these domains are very intermingled.
It's interesting in itself, maybe. Yeah.
Thank you.
Guy?
Fascinating, Stan. I think the intracranial stuff is really tailored to your needs because you could exploit the temporal resolution and basically do what Giacomo also showed, it is that you align the recording with the different events in the sequence. At a certain point you said these are single traces, so it wasn't clear how much repetition there was, how much variability. I haven't seen any variability on your curves, so I don't know how, you just had lines, so I don't know how variable things are. I'm sure you do statistics to do your regressions, of course, I'm sure of that. But it was difficult to get any sense of variability. You just had these lines, yes.
So maybe here, yeah.
No,
so
this is fine, but here, so I don't know how many repetitions there are.
So each line is one sentence here.
Yeah.
So you can see, for instance, I think it's something like 15 repetitions, but they are not really repetitions. They are 15 sentences with the same structure, three-word structure.
N is 15, and then you have some
and then you have some
variability around the lines. The next slide. In the next
Next line is four words, five words.
No, in the next slide.
Slide. Like this one.
You had one where you had the lines, and those lines.
Yeah.
There's no variability.
You're right. No, that's interesting. There should be. I think you cannot see it.
There is
an error bar around here, and it's important because we have fewer sentences with six words.
Otherwise, you cannot appreciate what is different
from each other. Now, for instance, they completely overlap here, and the blue curve is much more reliable than the red curve because there were fewer structures with six words. That's quite important.
Okay.
So again, we are trying to extend this work to have exactly, now that we know we expect this, right, we will have exactly the same number of structures of different lengths and so on. And that will be important.
Yeah.
And I think the Jabberwocky will be very important as well.
So. Thank you.
Further questions? One more question, and then we unfortunately have to finish.
Yeah, regarding your mathematics language, I'm just curious, have you done an experiment? I mean, instead of presenting a mathematical language, once our concept, I use an analogy in English language, and then go back to the mathematical language, and how would that be how would that difference from each other?
Could you give an example of analogy, what you have in mind?
Now I say that there are two different types of infinity. That's a mathematical concept.
Mm-hmm.
But for those of us who do not know what is infinity, I say I take a mapping. A kid do not know how to count. If there are more seat, if everybody take a seat, if there are more seat than the people, then we say that one have a bigger set than the other.
Mm.
That's a English language that one can deduce.
Right.
But when I say there are two different type infinity, You said, what is that? How could there be two different time infinity? That's a mathematical concept. So I just wonder, how would that...
Well, I don't know how to respond to that. It's a great suggestion, but I think you're sort of making the assumption that analogies are made in language. But I think even in your example, they might not be. I think you mobilize concepts of sets and imagery and so on. Even though it's conveyed by language, the substrate for this sort of reasoning may not be inside language itself.
Well, one can show picture, you see. That I'm just happen to be, now you ask me, that's why I use the concept of set. If not, I just show you some picture to say that which is bigger group, you see.
But I think I can sympathize also with what you are saying. I think that this sort of language generative process that I was discussing allows you to think completely new ideas, including infinity. You can, for instance, in language, you can say bigger than infinity. Okay, you can say it. It's a valid formula, and then you might wonder, does it mean anything? I think there is a lot of that happening in mathematics. You know, square root of minus one. I can think about it, but is it a valid concept? Can I work with it? Well, the great thing about the human mind is that I think we can form these thoughts, and then we can see if they validly apply to structures in the external world. And some of them do. Surprisingly, square root of minus one is a valid concept. We can go quite far with it. So I think this is at the heart of the ability of humans to understand the world. We have an over-generative capacity. And it all comes from inside, and we project it to the external world. I think also Yuri Buzaki says something like that. I liked it very much. You know, this idea of being able to generate many, many different neuronal sequences, and then inside that, some of them match or do not match with what we need at a given moment. And we select.
I would love to continue this debate, but we have to start now a shorter coffee break. And we convene when Karin will give the signal. So maybe 50 minutes, maybe 20 minutes. And just one note about Professor Sidney Brenner. You know he's approaching 90 in January, so he will be here for a shorter while, but we are very much honored by his presence here. So Stanislas, thank you so much for this brilliant talk.
Pleasure.
And those who have questions, please ask from Stanislas during the break.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. That was good.